Hi, welcome to Books in Action. I'm Melissa Kopecky, the director at the South Orange Public Library, and one of the lovely opportunities I get is to host this program. I'm very excited about our program tonight. We have a very special guest talking about a great topic. So here is Village Trustee Stephen Schnall, only I'm going to call you Steve.
Please do.
Fair enough. And we're going to be talking about South by South Orange, which you could see right here, an absolutely great inaugural event. But first, I'm going to ask you to sort of tell us some of the things that you'd want us to know about yourself. Or that we wouldn't want to know.
Well, you may not want to know. Not much to say. I came to this village about 15 and a half years ago from Manhattan, New York City, actually where I was born. I was born in Brooklyn, raised in Queens. But then went off and did a few things, but came back and did most of my professional career post-college in the city. And it was I was very fortunate to come to South Orange, as I said, about 15 years ago. My wife was pregnant, and we were looking, as many people do here, we were looking for a easy commute because we were both professionally working in the city. We wanted to be relatively close to our child who was growing up, or hopefully would be growing up. And this was, we really chanced upon this place. And that's, I think, is actually kind of unique because I think most people self-select into this wonderful community. So we were kind of blessed and lucky.
Well, that's wonderful. And I have to say, I think South Orange is very lucky to have you. I have only known you for the past couple years, but it's been doing very interesting things. So, it was 2-3 years ago you were elected to village government. So what was your inspiration to run for office?
Well, I think I got my arm twisted with my
inspiration. Well, that's quite it.
My inspiration was actually the fact was after working for 30 years in a career that was mostly around technology and management consulting, I was very fortunate enough to effectively retire and not have to work and choose freedom to do with my time. And with that time, I was looking to explore meaningful engagement, and I was approached and asked if I would be willing to consider a role in village government. And I was intrigued by the idea. I had never done anything in government, really. A little bit during college, I was involved in student government, but that was about it. And I found it to be a great opportunity.
I hear you were president of your class in third grade.
In third grade, perhaps. In my own mind, actually. I was a little unique growing up, so I don't think too many people would have voted for me.
Oh, you were the weird kid.
I was definitely the weird kid, the nerd, for sure.
Well, and there is something weird in the most wonderful sense of the word about this South by South Orange project, and I think if we just start talking about that, then we'll get to know more about you and about South Orange, and it's really interesting ideas. So as the library director, I knew you were talking about this, and I just can't say enough how exciting it is. So give me a little synopsis of what it is, and then we'll go from there.
What it is, it's a little bit inspired by name from a marketing perspective from that little festival that goes on in Austin, Texas.
Yeah, South by Texas or
yeah,
something.
Something like that. We actually, I'm not sure if I share this with you yet, but actually this will be the inaugural and only year of South by South Orange. That's not to say the event, the festival, will not live on, but the folks in Austin have heard about this and have asked us to stop using it, cease and desist. And we actually,
they
were very
play on words.
Well, and it worked very well because, quite frankly, doing something the first time is the real challenge because there's no track record, no history, no way of pointing back at success or any event. So they were very reasonable, very pleasant about it. We understand why they need to protect their mark and their trade and their logo, et cetera. So we came to a very good conciliatory agreement that we would be able to use it throughout up until the end of the event and then choose a new name going forward. So it actually worked out okay.
Actually is a really reasonable sort of agreement.
It is. And so, again, it's sort of inspired by what they did, which is to bring together musical events, which typically happen in the evening, and then during the daytime they engage in more intellectual and inspirational types of idea exploration. So that's what we're doing. And what you'll see is an amalgam for 3 days, Friday night through Sunday night, of music, ideas, technology, all coming together under one, what I think is actually the secret. So the name is cute, and it's nice because people recognize it. But the theme of creative collisions, I think, is actually the inspiration. And the idea is we live in a community that is full of collisions. And it's not the type that car insurance companies are afraid of hearing about, right? So, you know, when you hear collision, you get upset or angry or disturbed. Not in this community. We embrace our collisions, whether they be, you know, socioeconomic, racial, ideological. We experience them all the time here. And I do believe our makeup of the people, the residents here, is that we look at them and try to find a productive way, a creative way of dealing with those juxtaposed issues. So that's what the conference, the festival ideas explore, are positions that somewhat feel somewhat contradictory, but end up being hopefully resonant and at least provocatively interesting.
And I mean, that was partly what got me excited about this idea, is that sense of fit with South Orange. Besides the fact that, obviously, as a librarian, well, you know, South by Southwest got really interesting when they got a bunch of librarians involved, and that's when a lot of that more idea-based programming came in. There were educators, too, but, you know, librarians are a very special kind of
thing. They are indeed.
All right, my pitch is aside. I'm done with that. But this fit with South Orange, I mean, that is what makes it such an exceptionally interesting place, is because there are always those interactions, and that idea of collisions is nice because you get this little mental picture of sparks flying.
Exactly.
So, okay, so give me a sampling of some of the events. There are so many events, and there is a website, obviously, and you could just fry your brain looking at the events, and I mean that in the best possible way.
Okay. Well, I do urge our viewers to take a look at it. And so one of the intentions of the program, there's a lot of sort of sub-goals in putting this on. There really are a number of different things that we've talked about now that we've, you know, there's a committee of people who are putting this on. And there are these sub-goals, and I think one of them, though, is to find something for everybody in town that's attractive to them. Because, you know, my opinion is, and so part of the origination of this also is I chair the Public Information and Marketing Committee. And the role of that committee is to, using communication, to both communicate currently with our residents in both directions, have them inform us and for us to disseminate information, but it's also to talk externally. And that, I think, is a relatively new thing for this village. Our previous village president did, I think, a very nice job at going outside and sort of as an ambassador presented South Orange as a place where people would want to know about and perhaps visit or indeed move here. And I think this is an extension of that, is to show this community as a very vibrant, engaged, participatory community. So that's part of those sub-themes, is to find something for everybody. And I do believe that. So some of the sessions, they really vary. We have a session on drones. We're actually going to have drones with little video cameras going around, and that might create issues around privacy issues, safety issues, both pro and against, right? So it should help public safety, but it might make you feel a little disturbed. We have about storytelling and myth. There is, well, I could go on, and I think the website is a great place to visit, and perhaps we'll talk more about some of the sessions in a little bit, too.
Okay. But, So your first act in getting this going was talking to people, right?
Yes.
And bringing people together, which is something you do very well, but it's also, again, that South Orange sort of
thing. It's our way.
So, and actually mention some of your partners, because that is another South Orange thing that, and that something for everyone sort of brings in the some different elements.
Indeed, one of our first partners, both as an individual and then as a organization that he represents, came from Dean Michael Zavada, who is the Dean of Arts and Sciences for Seton Hall University. And we both are sitting on the SOPAC, the Governor Board. So in conversations and discussions around the cultural arts at SOPAC, we were talking about arts education. And Dean Michael Zavada talked about curriculum that you've heard probably about STEM, S-T-E-M, the acronym, right, for science, technology, engineering, and math. But Mike had a really interesting take on it, which I had not heard about at that time. So this is almost a year ago. But it clicked in my mind, and he called it STEAM, adding an A into that acronym that isn't arts. Just a process, but it's the arts, right? And so that was a collision. And that was one of my first thoughts of these collisions is, and oftentimes we use this analogy about left brain and right brain, process, analytical process thinking versus the creative thinking. And that's something that was very much resonated with my life. I talked about being a nerd. I really was a very much math-oriented process kid. I was a computer science and math major in college. But I've always loved the arts and always liked exploring it. So the combination of those, I think, is what makes really interesting conversations and exploration.
It's very funny. I frightened a whole bus full of kids and parent chaperones coming back from a Broadway play as I was one of the chaperones, and started talking about how much math and music and engineering and the arts, and this was a really long time ago, had in common, and how could anybody sit there and have enjoyed the show and not have any appreciation for the math or the science or, you know, all those pieces that were part of it. And I scared them all, and I just sat down and stopped talking.
But I bet it resonated. I bet you that was something they took. They may not have gotten it at the moment, but that is clearly an important aspect.
Well, absolutely. Well, the math and music, and now the technology in music, I mean, it's more and more... there's more and more crossover, I guess.
So can I share one event that I think is worth featuring and talking a little bit about? Is really, we have a couple of things, and that's the intention. We do promote it as arts, ideas, and music, and sometimes they actually connect, or we'll see what happens when they hit each other. So the Friday night event, which is one of the feature events, we're calling it Teching Ball, which is a little bit derivative of Miley Cyrus's Wrecking Ball. So again, we're trying to use a little play on words that people might catch. You're already thinking of that video. I know you are.
No, I was thinking what an idiot I am that I read Teching Ball and never got the Wrecking Ball thing.
Well, then we didn't do such a good job with the promo.
Well, no, and as soon as you say it, it's much more apparent.
So the idea is actually a resident in town who used to be a professional musician for years. Out of the Boston area, he was played in a band. You know, it's hard to make a living out of that. So after a few years, I think he really enjoyed himself. But he got to the point where I think he was considering growing up, having a family, and he needed a more stable income. And he got into technology, and he's now a product manager for a big technology firm.
Okay, I just want to warn you here. We're going to take a break in a second. So
it's getting just exciting.
I know, and I'm going to cut you off, so we'll have that like hanging moment, like end of the season thing while we take our break.
Stay tuned.
So go, and I'll just chop you off at some point. We'll say, you know, finale in September.
The sequel is going to be even better, I'm sure. So should I continue a little bit?
You have like 10 seconds. So 10 go
seconds,
right ahead.
Okay.
He wanted to lead a normal life, so he got into technology, although that's questionable. About how normal a life that is.
That's true. That's a little abnormal. but anyhow, so we were talking, and he's a really creative guy, and we were exploring these different juxtapositions.
Okay, cut.
Wow, okay.
I told you, 10 seconds goes fast.
After 17 years working as a mason, Mike was laid off. I met him when he came into the library looking for help. He found a job opening, but the application was only online. Mike said he'd spent his entire life around tools, but had never used a computer. I showed him how, and he ended up applying for numerous jobs online. I saw Mike the other day. His new computer skills paid off. He's working again.
New Jersey libraries are transforming lives. Tell us your story.
Hi, I'm Melissa Kopecky again, and we're back at Books in Action, and this is such an action-packed adventure that we yelled cut when we went to the break, and so now I'm saying, what do you say, uncut?
Paste.
And here, I say continue, droid. This is Steve Schnall, Village Trustee and originator and brain and weird imagination behind South by South Orange, the Festival of Arts, Ideas, and Music, and STEAM and STEM and SEAT and all the different ways we talk about those things. And we were right in the middle of a story about one of the really cool events, and it started with a musician who wanted to become normal. So he, we haven't said his name, and someday he's gonna get us both. No, he wanted to become normal and took up a life as a tech in tech.
Yeah, I don't know if he wanted to be normal. He's, you know, we're all a little abnormal.
Right.
I think he wanted
to
have stability.
More normal.
Oh, yes, he
more
wanted a little
stable life.
Little
okay,
stable
that's
life.
Good. Okay. But no horses involved.
Okay. There might be. I'm not sure. but he, but his creativity, I think, is what continued. Even though, again, he's got to more process as a product manager. He had this idea of how these two worlds come together, and in the world of technology coding. It's not uncommon to have coders, programmers, being inspired by music. They'll be wearing headphones, and whether it's classical or hard rock or whatever it might be, somehow or other it works with their coding. He was exploring if the reverse might be the case. Might there be an instance where the musician might be informed and riff off of a coder? And what would that experience look like? So we're creating an environment that's actually going to be on the loft at SOPAC, where that's going to be going on. On one side of the room, on one stage, will be musicians. On the other side of the room, there will be programmers, coders, user experience designers, and they're going to be playing off each other. And potentially in the middle, all the participants, maybe we might be able to crowdsource some information that they inform the overall design and coding. So I think it's going to be really experimental. And really exciting to participate, because I have not heard of this ever happening before.
I have in a really small way at a library, and I have to say a friend of mine, a librarian elsewhere, had sent me something about it,
okay.
Saying
so please
this
share.
Is a South Orange sort of thing.
Ah, nice.
And
I
just looked at it briefly. It was a very small event, okay. And I don't know how much it was, but it was definitely a musician and a coder and something like that. I am so excited about this event. This is when I was like, this is going to be the best festival
I think
ever.
It really will be, and I think it's a little groundbreaking. And, you know, each time you put one of these things on, one of the things that we're excited about is there's no such thing as failure. It's going to be an experience. And one of the things that you might ask me is how do we
what would that be?
is how will we know this is a success at the end after the event? Would
oh,
you ask
that's
me that?
Interesting. I wouldn't have.
Oh.
So I'm always glad to take ideas from a brain that works differently than mine. So Steve, at the end of this festival, how would you measure your success?
You know, that's a good question.
It is, isn't it? Thank you.
I think there are a few things. But first and foremost is that the people who attend are talking about it. There's a buzz. And obviously social media is such a big part of our lives these days. That we're, you know, already Twitter is being used. Our hashtag is South by South Orange is being used. And I expect that to just pick up and really, you know, gain momentum. And on the Monday afterwards, I'm hoping as people get on the trains in the morning, if they're commuting back to work or they're wherever they're going, they're talking about this. And there should be a buzz about how provocative and interesting and how it was exploratory. It may not all succeed. I think there's incredible talent, and that gets to one of the other missions of the whole event, is that it's homegrown talent. We have incredible people around our village who are musically inclined and technology strong and all these things. So we're bringing those all together in an environment to explore. And, you know, again, not afraid of the outcome. So in measuring success, it's not your traditional. It's not about whether we make money. It's not whether, you know, people clap necessarily, although that's always a good thing. We encourage that.
Actually, so. I always thought dead silence prior to clapping is the perfect response.
That would be. Yeah, so if you can sort of tell people to hold off and then at a clap, get excited,
like
stand
they're
up.
So blown away that they just can't even
awe-inspiring.
Find their hands
exactly.
At first.
Yes.
So
that would be terrific.
I think another measure of success would be is if you have people complaining afterwards that they couldn't get to everything because there was so much and it was so interesting and it was so hard to like decide what to do or work the things you had to do apart from this.
That's part of the collision. You're absolutely right. So during, at every time, there are at least, I think, three sessions going on in different venues all at once. And so that's exactly right. We want to make it difficult for people to decide what they're going to do or maybe bounce in a couple things. We're allowing flow. Just so I also want to share, most of the event will be general admission. There's not seating except for the Saturday night performance. So that's a special thing. I need to talk, just at least spend a couple of seconds talking about that. Mike Griot, who's a local musician and just fabulous brainstormer and marketer and all these great things, is putting together, he's musically directing the Saturday night show on SOPAC's main stage. And there is a small, a $15 incremental charge for that performance because that does require specific seating. But everything else is going to be general admission, so get there early, choose the sessions that you're interested in so you don't get locked out and have that experience. But if you do, we can pretty much guarantee you, even if you're locked out of that session, there'll be something going on that you'll find equally as satisfying.
Do you want to say a little bit about what's happening at the Saturday
thing?
Because these, yeah. I mean, I wanted to talk to you about this particular, just because the ideas are so interesting. So I want to jump around to some more of the collisions and the different ideas. I know you have your programs like tagged with different things about whether it's an ideas or music or an arts or these two together or
that's
whatever.
Right.
So give us a little bit of the sort of big picture, the thought behind that Saturday night.
Yeah, so the Saturday night is an experience, I think, for Mike, who's been in music and arts for so long, I think we've given him a chance to try something out that he's never done before. So he's musically directing 10 different musical acts in different genres. And that's part of this collision, right? Is you're gonna have a beatbox player, you're gonna have a traditional classically trained pianist, you're gonna have someone telling stories, a poet, that would be. All different genres of music, and in the background, video, a montage of activities that are going on that are gonna be, you know, it's all scripted together. And what's different is this is not just a pure mashup, right? So that would be a collision that might not be satisfying, but he's directing it in such a way that there's a story that's gonna unfold. And I believe, and I guess I'm giving away a little bit, but I think Mike would allow it for our audience. He's opening with a salute to Joe Cocker, who passed away in the last year. One of the performers actually was one of Joe Cocker's background singers, so she'll be singing. And unfortunately, we lost B.B. King, another musical giant, and there'll be a little bit of a reference to B.B. King as well. And this is going to be performed by a bunch of phenomenal, couple Grammy-winning performers. Will Calhoun from Living Color will be with us. It promises to be an incredible performance, so really excited.
So some of the other ideas, I know you're doing something about sports, which is not the first thing you think of when you're talking about music and arts and ideas, but why not?
Yeah, well, and that's the thing, and I think that the sports one, as you mentioned, they reference different things, and so even though this is targeted at a not necessarily a child, but more of an adult-oriented, mature person who you know is interested in these topics, we still as parents we think about our kids. So this session on sports is kind of this collision of thinking about single-focus sports, like should I be an expert and just do something all year round and become the best at it, or should I do a multi-sport? Should I take on three different sports and there are pros and cons with that, and there's a number of constraints and considerations. And so we're going to hear from a person who's in high school sports, college sports, and club level sports, and they're going to sort of relate their experiences with kids on what makes most sense. And I'm sure it's going to come to an individual take on it, but I think it's going to be a really interesting conversation with coaches in our own school systems. Sharing how they've worked with their kids. So that's going to be really neat.
And certainly full of a lot of ideas that translate to something else.
Because
exactly. You have the parents who sold their house to buy the right cello for their kid. I mean, it's not just sports.
That's right. One other session which I wanted to share that I think is going to be, it's one I'm looking forward to, I think maybe the tops, is the sort of anti-concept of the romantic sense of the poor, starving artist. And in our society, very frequently, we think about our artists living on a sixth floor of a sixth floor walk-up in the bad part of town because that's all they can afford and they're eating scraps, right? And why is that the case? Why do our creatives sometimes be forced into that type of environment at the same time we might really reward financially our financial wizards and bankers and such? And it's not about necessarily equity, but it's an interesting conversation. And so we've put together a panel of artists of different forms. There's a theater person, there's a fine arts person, there's musicians, photographers, and they're going to share their own stories on how they are dealing with their art in terms of trying to make a living out of it. Or have they switched, you know, are they waiters, bartenders, or have they found a way to take their art to a level where they can be commercially reimbursed and rewarded? So I'm really looking forward to that panel conversation.
And what a nice sort of flip side to this whole sense of celebrity and the arts and this sense of that it's the making money is the goal,
right?
You know, it's not about making the art, to how refreshing to sit and listen to people to whom it's about what's driving you,
exactly.
The ideas behind it.
Yeah. Yeah, so that collision of ambition and interest and desire, following one's passion, one's heart, but also living in the reality of society is a challenge. It's a collision for all of us.
So remember that really brilliant question I asked you about what measures success? In the longer term, like, how would you like this exchange of ideas, these creative collisions, to sort of be reflected in South Orange?
My hope is that the event...
And again, I'm asking you with not a whole lot of time to answer, so come on.
I'll do what I can.
Speed up and give me some great answers.
So my hope is really that the event does not end on June 28th, and that this becomes the catalyst. Really, these discussions are hopefully provocative in nature, because it's a short time. Each session is going to approximately be an hour and 15 minutes, so we're not going to solve world peace. But hopefully we raise issues and conversations that we can then create new projects or volunteer efforts or discussions that will allow people to come together to solve
this problem. Okay, and for the person, I'm sorry, I know I'm interrupting, but mm-hmm. for the person who missed it, they, you know, were out of town that month or something, is there going to be some of it that's going to be available after the fact?
We're fortunate to have WSOU from Seton Hall. Again, Seton Hall has been a great partner with us, as has St. Barnabas and SOPAC and the Village Center Alliance. We didn't get a chance to get them all in, but WSOU is going to be working with our Village volunteers and our staff to archive as many of these as possible. So we're hoping that the audiovisual gods will be with us and we'll be able to have them taped and archived for future viewing.
Well, and also if you're talking about social media, there'll be a lot of sort of, to the social media thing, you've got to get people actually connecting ideas their reporting of what happened.
That's right.
And then you could say, this is a direct appeal.
That's right.
You could stimulate, you know, more creative collisions by just sharing.
And at the end of the day, the measure of success is that people want it for next year. And that's really what we're hoping, is that they'll ask us to come back again.
Okay. Thank you for your time. And.